I'm the owner of the Palladium, the home of the Mambo. Play nothing but Mambo music here. We have the greatest music in the country at the Palladium.
Does everybody know where or what the Palladium is all about? The Palladium is the home of the Mambo. Everybody used to go up to the Palladium, which was a big ballroom located on 53rd Street and Broadway.
Look who we had to dance with. We had Tito Puente, Machito. We had Tito Rodriguez.
It was my first exposure as a Puerto Rican from the barrio to the so-called American element. And you had blacks, Puerto Ricans, and Italians, because the Italians were all over the place.
We called them Mambo Knicks. People, you know, like, instead of beatniks or something, they were the Mambo Knicks. They followed the Mambo.
The subway was right outside the entrance of the Palladium, down the block, so you could literally hear the music pounding from the stairway of the train, and people would start dancing on the pavements.
And everybody was jumping up and down upstairs, dancing. The whole place was rocking.
And then you had the biggest bouncers I've ever seen stationed around the Palladium, because there were a lot of connected guys there.
Marlon Brando would come in and sit in on bongos. Sammy Davis come in and sit in on a conga drum.
You'd walk in that place and there'd be like a purple, green, orange haze coming out of it with so much marijuana in there. And the bass was smoking, man.
The sound of our lives. Latin music of the 50s and 60s was what kept us going.
The music that was written in those years for those bands is the greatest music ever engineered that will ever, ever be written in our genre. That will never happen again.
Enchants us, and it keeps us coming back for more. And something about that music that makes you want to get up and party and dance, because it is a spiritual sense of freedom.
Today we call it salsa, a Latin big band blend of fiery music and sensual dancing. Tito Puente objected, saying salsa was what he ate, not what he played. Yet today, salsa represents more than a marketing term. It's a musical genre woven over centuries with flight, invention, jazz, and culture. Strangely, this music that's so uplifting has its origins in human suffering.
The roots of Afro-Cuban music, whether it be charanga, Latin big band, small band, which we call conjunto, is all from Africa. Everything we trace back to Africa.
This richness of music that is centuries old has traveled within the African diaspora to the New World, meaning the Great Antilles, Cuba, Puerto Rico, and Haiti and Santo Domingo.
The rhythm patterns of these people comes from the Yoruba tribe, which were the most sophisticated drummers in Africa.
There's something majestic about the drum, and very visceral.
always been called savage music. It's not savage at all. Probably one of the more sophisticated musics on the planet.
The Spanish conquistadors, they sort of turned their face, turned the other way to the music of the slaves. Let them have their music, let them have their dancing, let them enjoy themselves a little bit. Much different from the slave owner in the U.S., who was such a control freak. They took the drum, they took their names, they took everything.
They never allowed their drum here. By not allowing the drum, they lost the Africanism. And little by little, from working eventually the plantations and all that, what you came out of there was the blues, the classic blues. But the Caribbean is different because the black African captive is allowed his drum.
The drum is part of the language. So I think because of the drum, blacks in Cuba, in Puerto Rico, in Haiti, and Santo Domingo were able to retain some of the language and some of the customs.
If you didn't have a drum, you wouldn't have music.
The drum, which is what imitates the pulse of life, is the essence of our music.
The West African rhythms took root in one Caribbean island above all others.
The mambo is Cuban, the cha-cha-cha is Cuban, the danzón is Cuban, the guaracha is Cuban, the son is Cuban, the son montuno is Cuban, the guajira is Cuban. You can't find another country that's given us as many things as Cuba has given us.
The bedrock of African-Cuban music was transformed by Arsenio Rodriguez, a master of the Cuban mandolin known as the Tres. Arsenio took the Cuban folk tradition called El Son and created an original, bigger sound.
Arsenio Rodriguez, here's a man born in the Congo who was kicked in the head by a mule when he was 8 years old and blinded. Before Arsenio, all there was sextetos and septetos. There was no formal orchestra. They were charangas, but there was no orchestra or conjuntos. So what Arsenio did, the first thing he did is he added the conga drums to the orchestra. Can you imagine a Latin orchestra without a tumbadora, without a conga drum? I mean, it's practically unimaginable to me. Well, he was the first one to add a conga drum to the septetos. After that, he added a piano. There were no pianos in the bands. So they were just little guitars and one trumpet. Then he added two trumpets, then three trumpets, and then written arrangements for the trumpets.
Arsenio's new sound established an intimacy between the musicians and the dancers, a dynamic that inspired the mambo.
He was the first one to use the word mambo.
Mambo was a section of the song that the dancers would escalate their movement and get more excited.
In 1930, while the Depression was raging, Americans were looking for a diversion. Little did they know what was headed their way.
As far as the music getting here to the United States, the first band that comes here to really expose Cuban music on a mass level is the Don Aspiazu Havana Casino Orchestra. They come to New York City in 1930. And all of a sudden, people for the first time are seeing instruments that they've never seen or heard before in a theater setting. Bongo, claves, maracas, timbales. These rhythms that are very, very exotic to the average person at that time. They see an orchestra that's multiracial. They have a trumpet player named Humberto Chino Lara, who's a Chinese Cuban. Then they look at the rest of the band. Some of the guys look Italian, some of the guys look Greek or whatever. It's a perfect example of what the Caribbean is. So this was a very exciting thing.
Beyond culture, the Don Aspiazu Havana Casino Orchestra crossed another Rubicon and created the first Latin hit across America, El Manicero, the peanut vendor.
He had a very flamboyant singer named Antonio Machin who came out singing the peanut vendor and throwing peanuts to the crowd. It was a great gimmick. Everybody went nuts. As soon as it came out, within a year of that release, the major jazz performers in the United States covered it and recorded it and did their own versions of that. And I think quite revealing is Louis Armstrong's version, because it shows you where the American public was really at in terms of their perceptions of Cuba. I'm sure he didn't speak Spanish. And he starts to do a little scat, and he doesn't know Spanish, so he just throws the word Spanish in there. And it really shows you that he himself probably viewed this as more of a novelty and not as something that was necessarily going to be here to stay.
Yet, as they say in Hollywood, the peanut vendor had legs.
Let's dance.
Oh, do you think if you ask me while we're dancing, you'll have better luck?
Let's try.
The peanut vendor foreshadowed a classic conflict between the authentic African-Cuban music and the homogenized version for the mass market. After the peanut vendor struck gold in the U.S., many Americans ventured to the source of the music. Cuba. The mob in America took note of the infatuation, and soon big casinos, easy sex, and a flashy nightlife were part of the African-Cuban beat. The biggest star at the casino hotels was Benny Moré, nicknamed the Barbarian of Rhythm. Moré took the son tradition of folk music and infused it with a big band sound. A child of poverty who worked in the sugarcane fields, Moré was a self-taught performer who never forgot his roots. In 1945, Moré moved to Mexico and performed and recorded with Damaso Pérez Prado, whose hit Cherry Pink and Apple Blossom White sold millions worldwide and proclaimed him the King of Mambo.
I play for you your favorite number, Cherry Pink, the trumpet solo, Jaime Calderón.
Just internationalized mambo. Mexico also, let's not forget, they had a film industry. It was very important in those days before television. And all of a sudden you saw somebody who was sort of directing and singing, you know. And he was Pérez Prado, the mambo king, and that was it. And that's what you saw, and if you saw it, and that must be true, and that's it. You know, never heard about cachao or the Cuban side of stuff.
I remember the night, the first night I saw Pérez Prado. It was like seeing Star Wars for the first time. They were spread all over the stage, and he was in the middle, and he did all these wild dances, a little bitty dude, sharp, you know. And it's really, really exciting.
And he was a showman, and he brought it forward.
Pérez Prado never had a better student of showmanship than Benny Moré, who returned to Cuba to form his own big band.
Big bands had singers, but the big band had a name, Tommy Dorsey, and you are a singer for the Tommy Dorsey band. Benny Moré was Benny Moré.
Moré's popularity soared in Cuba, and he was hailed as the island's greatest entertainer on the level of Frank Sinatra.
Que te quiero,
When Benny More died of alcohol abuse in 1963, the response on the streets of Cuba was overwhelming. Like Benny More, another musician had developed his chops in the hotel bands. He was a clarinetist, a musical prodigy who, in 1920, graduated from the Havana Conservatory at age 9. His vision, personal journey, and musical knowledge would change forever the course of African Cuban music. His name was Prudencio Mario Bauzá.
He had won a contest to get a scholarship to go study classical music in Milan, Italy. But amazingly enough, at that very early age, he realized there was no future for a black man in classical music, in European classical music. So he turned down the scholarship.
He had part of his heart, if not much of it, in the Cuban dance music, which he clearly recognizes as an Afro-Cuban music.
And since he was a very, very, very good clarinetist, he got to play with a lot of well-known orchestras in Havana that played at the hotels. He told me that he was basically the only black musician allowed to play in these hotels, simply because he was so good.
What happens is the Mario's band comes to the United States. And for all of the greatness of Mario Bauzá's genius, I find this incredible assessment that he makes right then and there at the age of 16 to be the most shocking of his great insights and visions of genius. He comes to America, hears jazz, and goes, aha! This is the same thing that happened in Cuba, only different. What he meant was that African music had met the West in the New World, in the United States, and come out jazz.
You must take the A train to go to Sugar Hill, way up in Harlem. If you miss the A train, you...
Now he's thrust into the milieu of New York City, and he gets to see Harlem for the first time, and he sees that blacks have this enclave in New York City, the most cosmopolitan city in the world, and they're treated with respect. They have their own clubs, they have their own shops, people dress up, they look sharp, and there's even whites that come from downtown, uptown, to check out the music.
Mario was knocked out by the virtuosity of America's greatest jazz trumpeter, Louis Armstrong. And when Mario heard that Cuban singer Antonio Machin was short a trumpet player for a recording, the admiration turned into action.
Mario said to him, well, you know, Chino's not in New York anymore. He goes, I know, I can't do the recording. What am I gonna do? What am I gonna do? And he goes, well, you know, I think I can play trumpet. I think I can help you out. He goes, you don't play trumpet. He goes, I don't play trumpet now, but you know, if you buy me one.
This is an incredible shift of gears for a musician. The trumpet and the clarinet are not in the same family of instruments, so he's breaking his field of instruments. Jumping to trumpet, he's starting all over again.
That he had about 14 days, and he was able to get his chops up. Cuarteto Machin featuring Mario Bauzá on trumpet.
Though new to the trumpet, it didn't take long for Mario's raw talent to be recognized. In 1932, he auditioned for drummer Chick Webb's big band, recognized among aficionados as the hottest band in New York.
Mario said, Chick Webb told him, listen, man, you got what I need, and I got what you need. He goes, what do you mean? He goes, well, you know, you play very well, beautiful sound, beautiful intonation, but you don't phrase the music like a black musician does. I gotta teach you how to phrase and speak like a black musician does on the horn. And that's what I can give you. And what you can give me is your beautiful tone, your beautiful lead sound, and not only will you be the lead trumpet player, but you will be the musical director of this band.
And here's Mario Bauzá, now having really taken swing lessons from Chick Webb, swinging his band.
On Chick Webb's signature song, Stompin' at the Savoy, Mario inspired the original arrangement. played lead trumpet, plus took a clarinet solo.
From the Chick Webb Orchestra, which is the swinginest band, to the Cab Calloway Orchestra, which is the most visible band.
Here's a story about Minnie the Moocher. She was a red-hot hoochie-coocher.
And that, Mario Bowser's joining Cab Calloway's orchestra in 1939, is the cornerstone to the full whammy jammy of the big band sound of swing and jazz meeting Cuban dance music as Afro-Cuban music.
What is significant is what happened and who he was sitting next to in the trumpet section, which would change the course of Latin jazz history. It was Dizzy Gillespie.
Beyond musical director, Mario was a mentor, especially to Dizzy Gillespie, a young trumpeter intrigued by Mario's musical heritage. Dizzy was jazzed when Mario pushed the band towards Latin arrangements, while Cab flirted with the rhythm, but considered them novelty tunes.
They would ask, hey, Mario, what's the music of your country like? So he plays them some records of authentic Cuban music in the song tradition. And they start laughing at it and going, you know, hey, you know, that sounds like hillbilly music, country music. Yeah, it's the country music of my country, Cuba. And, you know, he makes a prophetic statement. You know something? One day, there's going to be an orchestra that's on the same level musically as this orchestra, the Cab Calloway Orchestra, and every great big band that's here in the United States. That's the inspiration for Machito and the Afro-Cubans.
In 1940, Mario Bauzá joined forces with his brother-in-law, singer Francisco Grillo, also known as Machito. Together, they created a band that fused the American jazz experience with their native love of African-Cuban rhythms.
The orchestra is named Machito and the Afro-Cubans. Not even African-Americans had used the term Afro-anything.
Anything African was frowned upon, even by African-Americans. It was looked down upon as something tribal, as something savage, something from another country that was not them.
Cab Calloway and his Afro-Americans, nobody did that. Mario wanted that because he knew that it's what it was, there's truth, and knew that it said black is beautiful.
They created a big band using jazz instrumentation, jazz arranging techniques. However, what was different is they used a Cuban rhythm section.
They're the first orchestra to use the triumvirate of the congas, the bongo, and the timbales. The congas, the closest link we have to West Africa. The bongo, the Creole instrument that was invented in eastern Cuba. The timbales, descended from the European timpani. So you have Africa, the Creole, and the European all together.
They're playing a new music, not playing a known music, that is combining remarkable components of both jazz and Latino music, combined to make it a new music, and playing at optimum all the leading elements of each idiom. Playing the new music, playing the Afro-Cuban music, and playing pure jazz music, all three well. This is quite a set of cards to be playing. Ace here, ace here, ace here.
Mario told me that he invited Cab Calloway's band to come see the band. These were the guys that had put down Cuban music, saying it was corny, hillbilly-ish, primitive. And all of a sudden, these black American musicians who have no concept of any polyrhythmic roots in terms of West Africa, you know, like deep roots. All of a sudden, these guys are like with their mouths open.
Contributing to the new sound was a 17-year-old Puerto Rican drummer who understood the complex polyrhythms of Cuba, though he was born and raised in New York City. His name was Ernest Anthony Puente Jr., affectionately known as Tito.
Tito Puente displayed virtuosity, musical vision, and an understanding of this innovation. He's immediately allowed to sit in at the very first performances on Central Park North in that basement club. And his uncredited playing timbales on some of the first Machito records for Decca, he's there.
Cab Calloway did acknowledge, after seeing the Machito Afro-Cubans, he did acknowledge it. He said that, well, this music is the music of the future.
It took a while for the new music to catch, but when it did, wildfire erupted. Suddenly, Latin music was the height of hip, and Machito and his Afro-Cubans were the stratosphere at clubs like La Conga, the Beachcomber, and the Park Palace.
There was a place called the Park Palace. That was the place that really gave rise to the Mambo Wars.
It was a neighborhood dance hall. It was our Puerto Ricans thing. Nobody else came in. We had the best of everything. Arsenio Rodriguez, Machito, Afarone Eki, Marcelino Guerra in them days, Noto Morales.
It was one thing to rock the house in East Harlem, but could this music travel downtown? When a lackluster Lindy Hop joint named the Alma Dance Studio changed its name to the Palladium in 1947, it also changed the course of African-Cuban music.
That's when Tommy Morton came in and started managing.
And all of a sudden, his business started to go down. The Latin music was very popular, and everybody was running to the Latin. And him and the rest of his partners got together, and they said, we got to get a band in here and make some of that money.
And Mario Bauza asked Mr. Morton, how do you feel about black people? And Morton's reply was, according to Mario Bauza, I'm only interested in the color of green, meaning money. He says, well, Mario suggests, let's try a Latin night and see how that works out.
When I went down for the opening night of that 3:30 in the afternoon of the Palladium with Machito, when I got downtown to 53rd Street and Broadway, do you know what was happening? Not one line, two lines around from 53rd Street, around Broadway, up 54th Street, around to 7th Avenue. Two lines. The cops had to close off 7th Avenue, Broadway. No traffic to go through because of the crowd. They thought there was going to be a riot. All for that opening of the Palladium.
Walking up the flight of steps just built a certain anxiety in you that, oh, I gotta get there, I can't miss what's going on.
If the band was on, you sort of danced up the stairs.
Everyone dressed in those days. Everybody had a suit and a tie and wingtip shoes and the whole bit.
The rest of the week, you know, my mom was a seamstress in a sweatshop, and we were students in these really rough high schools. The night you went to the Palladium, you were a princess. And so we would get all dressed up, and the minute you go up those stairs, you change.
And many of the older girls, a little older than I did, used to dress up, really dress to kill. Gold lamé and blackwood sequins.
There was this sense that you had entered another world. It would be noisy. You could not have a conversation because these bands would be going like crazy.
On the right-hand side, there was a kind of giant armchair, if you will, where everyone would sit watching the dances. And then on the left side, you'd have the tables.
And my mother came in her jewelry and her fur coat. And we, my father gave someone a tip and we got a cent a table.
Every Wednesday, you weren't any, you were square if you didn't go to the Palladium.
There was the sense of, I am a part of this music and this music is part of me.
It became chic to be there. Wednesday nights, you'd go and you'd see Sammy Davis Jr. and you'd see Marlon Brando and you'd see so-and-so from Hollywood, you know, and they'd want to be seen there.
And I said, who's your friend? He said, this is Novak, Kim Novak. I said, you got to be. I backed off, and sure enough, but she liked to dance.
Many of the celebrities started to converge on the Palladium. I remember seeing Marlon Brando there one night. He was playing the conga on a Wednesday.
That was really a spot more for the hip crowd, the in crowd, the celebrity crowd, the mobster, goodfellow crowd.
Candido has told me stories about Marlon Brando sitting in with the Machito Orchestra. And he even told me that, you know, he has tapes of Marlon Brando playing quinto, the solo drum in rumba. And he says, hey, you got to hear him play. He sounds really, really good. I mean, it's not no fake thing. He's really, you know, playing in the style authentically.
Ava Gardner come in and she loved to dance, okay? She had a certain appetite for chocolate, okay? And she would come in and dance with me.
And La Lupe was a singer herself and a performer, and she was there with an entourage. And Isabel Sarli was this very sultry, sort of like the Marilyn Monroe of Brazil. Of course, when they would get up to dance, definitely, even though they were not nearly as good as we were, you would part for them.
Dizzy Gillespie used to come up with Sarah Vaughan all the time, Lena Horne, Rita Hayworth. And I had the privilege of dancing one number with Liz Taylor.
Writers like William Burroughs, Allen Ginsberg. I go crazy when I see these things about Jackson Pollock. You know, this avant-garde concept and the swirls and this, you know, abstract thing. Man, what do you think he got that from? He's listening to mambo music. He puts a canvas on the floor, boom, he's listening to Machito and the Afro-Cubans, boom, he starts dancing and throwing the paint everywhere, man.
The forces of Africa, Cuba, jazz, and innovation had crystallized at the Palladium Ballroom. Now Latin music had a special time and a remarkable place. Machito and his Afro-Cubans concocted the original blend, but now the lid was off at the Palladium. New bands playing new arrangements erupted on the bandstand, twisting innovation into this brave new music. Everything was at its height, except the paycheck.
It was not music that was commonly heard. It was not played on mainstream general radio.
It wasn't a commercial place, really. It was a place where we tried to play the most authentic music.
The majority of them had jobs during the day, in a garment center someplace, or pushing a cart, or even a busboy, okay? But at night, they played their music. And the reason why they had that second job during the day was because they weren't in the position to make big money yet, as far as the musicians were concerned. And they were eager to show their music.
They were like a member of your family, even though you only saw them on the stage. The fact that they made it into something really, really colorful and special and unusual. And I know that we knew that something different was happening in Latin music, in the same way that I think African Americans of the time knew that something different was happening because of Motown.
When the Machito Orchestra started playing at the Palladium, a lot of times they wouldn't be able to play because they had commitments in either the Catskills or for other gigs. And so Mario Bauza encouraged Tito, well, form a little group so that maybe you could sub for us, especially on Sunday afternoon matinees at the Palladium. So the original Piccadilly Boys were formed, which was a small group that featured two or three trumpets, okay? And Tito started writing, obviously, arrangements for this small pickup group.
With competition breeding excellence, a rivalry developed among the headlining house bands, Machitos, Tito Puentes, and Tito Rodriguez's, whom the Palladium Mambo Knicks called the Big Three.
There were the three bands that sustain a level of quality, a level of intensity, and showmanship that had no parallel. They were the three.
They were all authentic. Let me start out that way. But Machito played Latin funk. That Afro flavor coming up.
He played a style that was more authentic, that was more closer to the roots.
Machito was the elder statesman. And I think of the three, Machito, we would have to say Machito was the band that was the most respected band as a whole.
Tito Rodriguez was romantic. He was a playboy. He knew how good-looking he was. And his music came out that way. He played for the women more or less than anybody else.
En la vida hay amores que nunca pueden olvidarse.
He had the most beautiful voice. Lyrical, emotional, loving, tender. And he was so handsome.
And he was influenced a lot by the great balladeers of that time period, most notably Frank Sinatra.
Now you got Tito Puente. Tito loved, he was authentic also. And he could be romantic also, but he loved jazz.
He'd write an arrangement which all his hits, what we call the hits and beats, are synchronized with what the trumpets are doing. Very synchronized percussion arrangement, very innovative. Nobody had ever done anything like that before.
Tito Puente was a monster arranging, and the sound that he would create out of that big band was just amazing.
There really was this sense of there being a competition among the bands to gain the hearts of the dancers.
I was playing with Machito, and Machito would start there at the Palladium, and we'd play the first set, and then Tito Puente's band would come in, and they'd come in really hot. And I said, how come these guys play the first tune they play, you know, be so exciting and up so much? And then I'd speak to the Tito Puente's musicians, well, we just rehearsed 2 hours in front in the Ed Sullivan Theater across the street from the Palladium.
Tito Rodriguez and Tito Puente were like the young Turks coming into the turf, and there was a rivalry between the two of them, which I think in those days, those rivalries created great music because they always wanted to top each other, and they were always competing for billing and positioning. But in order to justify that, they had to really play.
Tito would come out and see the guy who was putting the letters up on the billboards, and he'd say, my name has to come first. Then Tito Rodriguez would come out and make him stop and say, no, my name has to come first. Then Tito would come out again. No, my name has to... and on and on and on.
They were being offered a lot of money at times if one would take second Billy, and reached the point where a promoter would say, we won't say anything, we'll just say the two Titos. And they refused.
I had asked Tito Rodriguez, I wanted to tape him. So he said, okay, you
You can come to the 34th Street, I think it was the Alpine Hotel. And I forgot to go. And I went to Tate Puente instead. Big mistake. He heard about it, and from that day on, he never let me record again.
It got to the point where Tito Rodriguez, who many people don't realize, or the Mambo Knicks realized from that time period, that Tito Rodriguez was an excellent percussionist himself, an excellent timbalero himself. It got to the point where Tito Rodriguez started studying the vibes also, because he wanted to play vibes like Tito Puente.
Puente was very aggressive and you know, in your face kind of guy, and Tito was a singer. He was more more refined in his approach, a bolero, more romantic and whatnot, but also could be like in El Moldo de la Loca, he could just go at you to go for the throat.
Tito Rodriguez was always immaculately dressed, impeccable style, fully manicured, not a hair out of place. Tito Puente would have stains on his tie. His shirt would be out of his pants. He had more of that rumpled look to him, and he didn't care about that. He cared about the music.
But the man had personalities. They were two characters, and very disciplined. I think Tito Rodriguez perhaps was even more disciplined than Tito Puente.
Tito Puente and Mario Bauza and the people that were the founders that had to invent this music. You know, these are not samples, man. They had to make this up.
And they just gave everything out of themselves whenever they performed. So people, you know, just went wherever they were playing.
The Big Three competition elevated the music and energized the crowd. Pure showmanship reigned on stage and on the dance floor. Suddenly, the Palladium became as famous for its incredible dancers as its new world sound. The Palladium was pure eye candy, as the in-crowd raced to the home of the Mambo, as much to see the dancers as to hear the music.
You had the guaracha, you had a montuno, you had a son montuno, you had a bolero, you had rumba, you had guaguancó and ñáñigo. You put them all together, and out came the Mambo.
When you see good Mambo dancers on the dance floor with a good orchestra playing in clave, it gets so intense, it becomes like a religious out-of-body experience.
We used to stand around and just watch with our tongues hanging out.
These men were total strangers to me, and yet I could get on the dance floor with them, and they could get me to do things I couldn't do on my own in front of all these people, because we were both connected to this rhythm and what the rhythm meant.
Could you go out on a date with a girl and after 5 minutes have your arms around her and hold her close to you and put your cheek against hers? No way, she'd slap your face. But ask her to dance, you're right there.
So once you mastered Mambo, then you had to start all over to learn how to do cha-cha. And as soon as you mastered cha-cha, then the Cubans, they brought over the pachanga.
They had to know how to dance. It wasn't just talking, it wasn't come to my pad. It was, would you like to cha-cha? Or would you like to mambo? Or how about a bolero?
There was an area near the stage that the greatest dancers danced in. And if you weren't a good dancer, they would make it very clear to you that you were not welcome in that section.
The best possible thing that could happen to you as a dancer at the Palladium is that you would be dancing with this perfect partner, and everybody else would stop dancing and let you dance.
People would clear the floor to watch you dance. And then another team would come, and they would dance, and then they would switch partners. So it was like party time. So I guess that's when they came up with this contest idea. Like, why don't we do that? Clear the floor, make it a contest.
They had four dance teams. And they would put numbers on the back, and they would call them amateurs, right? Then they would pick people from the audience, and they would sit them right in front of the bandstand, and we would come out and dance, and they would write down, I think it was 1 to 10 or whatever. And at that time, we were making $15 to dance in the contest. If we won it, we get $5 more a piece. And would you believe we had to pay tax on that?
At first, the dance contest featured all amateurs, but ultimately certain teams became feature regulars. Augie and Margot, Elita and Michael, and Millie and Cuban Pete.
Everybody was like a show person, you know, putting on an exhibition on the floor.
I remember one night at, when the pachanga was first introduced, everyone was jumping in a kind of cadence, and the floor started to rock.
And everybody was jumping up and down upstairs dancing. The whole place was rocking.
And I remember Max Hyman running around the room screaming, stop, stop, stop. He thought we were going to crash down below onto the street level.
They were just great, great dancers, and that was the stimuli for the orchestra.
The whole idea of dancing to a live band is the band gets its energy from the audience, and the audience gets its energy from the band.
The Palladium's energy exploded off the streets of New York, where a new wave of immigrants arrived, and with them, a hunger for a musical identity. More than any other nationality, Puerto Ricans grabbed the torch of African-Cuban music.
When you walked down a street in our neighborhoods full of Puerto Ricans, you could not be in silence.
Yeah, I'm in Spanish Harlem. You know why? Because everybody's playing something.
It was the sound of our lives.
People who are in a bit of argument, I'm going out. I don't care, vete, lárgate, which means go ahead, who cares? And you know where they're going? They're going dancing. And you know what they do when they go home? Put on the music and make love. That's how the music attacked them.
America in the 50s may have been the land of the free, but it was still the land of discrimination. Yet within the four walls of the Palladium, the music and dance created a sanctuary, which was remarkably colorblind for its day.
The Palladium was one of the first ballrooms, really, that was on Broadway for the Latin people. Actually, Palladium was a place where they could afford to go. They could take a subway, get off in the corner, and go right to the Palladium.
Slowly, the Italians came in. Super, they were all right. Why not? The Jewish guys start coming in, super, they were all right. And we all mingled. It was vegetable soup.
It was my first exposure as a Puerto Rican from the barrio to the so-called American element, because, you know, we were kind of stratified at that time. But once in the Palladium, there was a kind of democracy there, a kind of equality, if you will. And you had blacks, Puerto Ricans, Anglo.
They didn't care if you were black or white, only if you could dance and dance good.
The Mamonics were basically white people that frequented the Palladium in New York City and were basically people that liked the dance, the mambo, and the cha-cha.
Larry Selden was Jewish, and so was Vera Garrett. I'm Italian, and Michael Terras is Spanish. Cuban Pete is Puerto Rican. I mean, you name it, we had it.
This sense that anyone, regardless of what your background was, the color of your skin, your age, how much money you made or how much money you didn't make, that you could all be there together was really meaningful and special, because that didn't exist outside of that building.
That was the first realization for me that Latin music was now starting to reach out and interest other nationalities and other groups of people.
Uh-huh, even the records say, what the heck is the mambo? And we know from your letters that you would like to learn the mambo if it didn't take too long and you could do it at home. So here is your teacher, Arthur Murray.
Although mambo, or the concept of using that word mambo to promote the music was a big thing, it started becoming a parody of itself to a certain extent when you get American pop stars trying to sing these novelty tunes, like Perry Como, Rosemary Clooney, and others doing these parodies of what the real deal is.
Señor, estás pachanga.
Sí, sí, estás pachanga.
Mujer con ti pachanga.
A Sudamérica.
Oiga, mulata. Yeah, papá.
Capitalize on the mambo craze, the best of the Palladium performers were organized to tour America.
There was one attempt at the Mambo USA tour that happened, I believe it was 1955.
I once went on a tour, it was called Mambo USA. And they hired the best dancers, the best bands, the best singers to tour the United States for 3 months. Chance of a lifetime for all of us. We left the three buses, all in love. We went first to the Fox Theater in Brooklyn, tremendous hit. Second, we went to Connecticut, tremendous hit. The next day, we went to Baltimore. That's where the Mason-Dixon line is. And then we had a rude awakening.
Cut off from the Palladium sanctuary, the tour hit the wall of discrimination.
I was on stage with my partner. I used to do a number called In a Little Spanish Town. And when I was doing the Little Spanish Town, there were about 15 black kids sitting down front. Young kids, maybe 14, 13, maybe up to 20. And that number goes, pa pa da pa da pa, pa pa da pa da pa, ooh, wah! That was a Perez Prado number. Well, those kids picked up on it, and whenever it came to the that climax of the crescendo, they would all chime in, ooh, what? In the middle of that rehearsal, Machito was playing rehearsing the number. Two cops come up to me and they say, hey, boy, you get those niggas out of here.
America could accept Hollywood's version, but not the real face of Mambo's diversity.
It was very unsuccessful. Mambo was supposed to be the biggest thing. And here they are traveling down south and in the Midwest and everything, and they're playing to empty chairs.
The three-month tour, which we had hoped we could finish, didn't last more than a month. It was just too tearful, too hurtful. It killed most of us.
Closer to home, the Palladium traveled well to the Catskills, where the Jews from New York vacationed in the summer and turned their mountain resorts into a mambo fest.
The baddest mambo dancers that I have ever seen have been Italians and Jews.
The Latin people, they have this stuff in their heart. They're born with this, with these rhythms. But the Jews had to learn that stuff. We paid thousands of dollars for dance lessons. You know, we had to eat a lot of gefilte fish and lox to dance like that.
You could go up to the mountains on any given summer weekend and hear Eddie Palmieri at the Pines Hotel, Tito Puente at Grossinger's, La Playa Sextet at the Neverly, smaller bands at dotting the rest of the Catskills.
These hotels have had dance instructors that would go from hotel to hotel and teach their clientele the cha-cha, the mambo, the tango, the samba, the lindy hop, whatever they wanted to learn. But there was lots of Latin music. It was very infectious.
I spent my summers in the Catskill Mountains for years and years and years and years and years. And my parents would take me to the Concord, and we would spend as much as 10 weeks there. And Machito was the house Latin band at the Concord. And I learned to do the cha-cha and the rumba and the mambo and the bolero and the merengue and all those wonderful dances.
Let me tell you about life in the Catskills as a single man. I was a dance teacher there. I was a dancer. On Sunday, all the men would migrate or run to New York.
Here are all these beautiful Jewish women, married women, who used to come up with their families for the summer to these hotels. They would take dance lessons from the dance teams, and they would have little 17 or 18-year-old daughters. The husband used to go back to New York on Sunday night, and then he used to say to me, I want you to keep an eye on my wife for me. you know. Now, I was the one that was going out with his wife. I was also doing the daughter in the afternoon, and then I would give him conga lessons on the weekend for $50 a pop. So, and it was like, went on like that for years.
They would say, Mike, here's $50. I want you to dance with my wife every night. And I danced with her all night till the wee hours of the morning.
It was a circle that kept going around. Nobody knew what was going on except the musicians and the dance instructors.
It started to fade. And then those hip people that were going to the mountains all switched and started to go to Fire Island and the Hamptons. Tito Puente was the most exciting person, instrumental musician, that I've ever seen on a stage, just by the very nature of what he played. And I think he brought a sense of American popular music done in a Latin style.
I've always thought Tito had the biggest ego ever existed.
I loved that about Tito Puente, that he knew he was good, and he wasn't going to pretend that he wasn't. There was no false modesty there.
You have a person that really knew his craft. I don't really call that ego. I call that pride.
When I was 15 years old, and Tito Puente gave me permission to sit next to him, and I watched him play his attack. I saw Tito Puente play. I just was mesmerized.
And he used to break 100 sticks a night. And I used to collect all the sticks at the end of the night, take them home, and I bought a pair of old Zimgar timbales, Mexican, the worst timbales. I always wanted to play the drums. So yeah, Tito played short sticks, so I had about half a stick a day with Tito Puente sticks.
He was not just a musician, arranger, composer. He was an extraordinary showman.
Tito didn't play two timbales. He played four of them, or six of them, and would dance around in a circle and do a show.
Took the timbales and brought them to the front of the orchestra.
He always looked at the instrument, not as an instrument just to play rhythms on, but as a musical instrument that was capable of many melodic tonal variations.
They call him Cuban King, he's the king of the
At age 16, Tito became a musician full-time, and within 2 years was playing drums with the Noro Morales Orchestra, where Tito gained his first film screen exposure. At age 19, Tito was at a crossroads, first with Machito and his Afro-Cubans, then with the U.S. Navy during World War II, when he was stationed aboard the USS Santee. There, Tito saw combat, learned arranging from his fellow musicians, and was the ship's bugler.
And as you know, the bugler, they sound reveille and a call to arms. He would always warm up his lips, his chops, you know, playing something, you know. Inadvertently, one day he had the microphone was on, and he starts to play a call to arms, you know, battle stations. So the whole damn ship goes into complete battle stations, only to find out that it was a false alarm. He says, so all you heard on the ship is, where's that little Anastito? Because we're going to kick his ass. Yeah, so he says, oh, I hid. For the next 3 days, you couldn't find little Anastito. He got, by the way, a presidential commendation for engaging the enemy in 9 sea battles. Never talks about those experiences.
Honorably discharged, Tito returned to New York to study music, courtesy of the GI Bill, at the renowned Juilliard School. While studying, he joined the Jose Curbelo Orchestra, whose lead singer was Tito Rodriguez, his childhood friend.
Vamos.
In 1947, Tito became the musical director and drummer of the Pupi Campo Orchestra. The next year, Tito stormed into the Palladium Ballroom.
They were doing a gig, and the piano player showed up late. And Tito, being the kind of guy he was, you know, one monkey don't stop no show. And he sat down at the piano, and he even did these solos that were incredible, and, I mean, he played.
Well, the vibes were his next instrument, and I heard him play it many times. He played it at Birdland, even. He played saxophone. And he played about five different sets of drums.
He just put two sticks in his hand and he'd go. Sometimes we'd arrive to play in a place out on the road where the crowd would be kind of scanty. And he'd play for 10 people as if there were 10,000 people out there.
We were flying on a flight and I messed up with my ticket. And I accidentally was placed in first class, which is fine with me. And Tito comes in and sits right next to me. I was like, great. All of a sudden he goes, oh no, I forgot my charts. I don't have any music. Does he have any music paper? I said, yeah. He said, how many horns are on this gig? And I said, well, there's six. He said, okay. And I watched him, just from memory, arrange with no piano, nothing. Three numbers for six horns. Now tell me, how many percussionists in this world can do that?
And as he went on in years, it still was impressive every time I saw him. When he was starting to reach his full stride and making good money, here he was playing the timbales, singing every song, and dancing.
You sit down with Tito, he'd tell you that Xavier Cugat was one of his favorite bands. A guy so hip, you would say, well, Xavier Cugat, why would he, you know, he was a dancer, and he loved to dance to that music.
He started out as a dancer. He used to do dance routines with his younger sister, 4, 5, 6, 7 years old.
So at a very early age, Tito learned the importance of dance, and he never forgot that as a band leader.
He really made you feel like he was playing that music for you.
Tito changed my life because I got to see him when I was 12 years old. He came to perform in a street concert. My heart was pounding. Everybody else's heart was pounding. He's just slaying everybody, man. He's the man.
His performance was in your face, aggressive, fast. Take no prisoners.
All of a sudden, the last chord of the arrangement, pow, comes in and you go, whoa, what is that chord, man? Well, it's Tito.
And Tito Puente's band was Charlie Palmieri, was Mongo Santamaria, was Ray Barreto, was Willie Bobo. I mean, and Tito. I mean, imagine all those people in one band.
Even though the instrument of timbales is a Cuban-born instrument, it's what we call un instrumento criollo, was born on the island of Cuba. The greatest player, the greatest protagonist of that instrument has been a New York-born Puerto Rican, Tito Puente. And he was very proud of being Puerto Ricano, even though he made his living playing Afro-Cuban-based music.
He was a role model second to none in the Puerto Rican community of the barrio because he was the first person to transcend the limits of that community.
And Tito at 75 was 15 years old. You know, the same verb we used to destroy New York together, man.
Kind of remind me of James Cagney. He had that same kind of persona, you know, larger than life thing. I think that carried him to the day he died.
The Palladium sound, tight, percussive, complex, and delivered with pure showmanship, today circles the planet. And no one ignited that world beat with more energy and understanding than Tito Puente. Today, his musical legacy resonates larger than ever. Witness Los Adolescentes Orchestra. The music of the Palladium not only traveled the world, it crossed musical genres, inspiring the likes and licks of Dizzy Gillespie, Charlie Parker, and other jazz legends. Birdland, the home of the new progressive jazz called bebop. developed first by trumpeter Dizzy Gillespie and his second-in-command, alto saxophonist Charlie Parker, featuring angular melodies, complex harmonies, and hypnotic solos. It was as difficult for the musicians to play as the audience to understand.
The Palladium was a couple of blocks removed from Birdland, and that was the mecca of the jazz world. So musicians would move back and forth to check each other out.
In the radius of probably three blocks, there were all the innovations probably that had happened in America in the last 50 years. It was like an incubator, spawning team. That's where everybody came to New York. If they loved bebop, they went to Birdland. If you wanted the right night, you'd go into the Palladium. It's an amazing time. I was like a kid. I was like Dracula at the Blood Bank. I was so excited. Every minute there was something to see.
Mongo and Eddie and Tito and Ray Barreto, who all love jazz. See, that's the key. The jazz musicians loved Latin music, and the Latin musicians loved jazz. So you would get Bird and Dizzy and Miles Davis and Thelonious Monk, and all the great stars would always find their way up there because the music was so exciting and so dynamic.
The marriage has always been there. They understood each other perfectly. It's almost like double time brass licks, you know, over this serious polyrhythmic rhythm section. And it's just like a train that you couldn't stop.
Dizzy Gillespie, Dexter Gordon, Stan Getz, Zoot Sims. These are all people that I saw actually playing solos with Machito's band.
You listen to the music of certain jazz things from the late 40s and 50s and even into the early 60s, you'll see many Latin devices in the music.
That's what happened with Cal Jada. He's playing with George Shearing. Al McKibben tells him, hey, let's go across the street. Tito Puente is playing at the Palladium. Oh, yeah. He goes over there. He sees Tito Puente playing vibes. He goes, wow, man, vibes in Latin music, in Afro-Cuban music. What happens? Caljero becomes a mambo nick.
Dizzy Gillespie, who was responsible mostly for this Latin jazz movement many years in the 40s, when he had this great Chano Pozo, and he did this great standard called a Manteca, which everybody knows. And he did all kinds of jazz things that always had that Latin rhythmic pattern involving.
Jazz was the maximum of harmonic structure. That's what was being fed to the conscientious Latin player. For example, how that influenced Rene Hernandez, who was the arranger of the Machito Orchestra when he comes from Cuba, when he hears Stan Kenton, when he hears Dizzy Gillespie, when he hears Count Basie's band. Wow, you know, and then he incorporates that naturally because of the jazz harmonic structures to the Machito Orchestra. That's why the orchestra and its recordings were just unmatchable and, you know, in the greatest orchestra we've ever had.
Renowned for his complex arrangements, Mario discovered a talent who took arranging for the Machito band to the highest level, Chico O'Farrell, considered by many the greatest arranger in the history of African-Cuban music. Mario and Machito had another secret weapon, Machito's sister, Graciela, the grand dame of balladeers.
Afro-Cuban and jazz music has always been married at the hip, always. They couldn't help it because it's about the same thing. They love very hip harmonies, very hip rhythmical values, and complex rhythmic values.
The old songs that came out of Cuba, the standards, the Vacilones and the Monkeys Wapacha, the beginnings of Cha-Cha-Cha and stuff like that, were very simple, had very simple lyrical content and musical content too. Basically, there are two or four chords, and the lyrics were mostly "A bailar, a gozar, I want to dance, I want to have a good time, come out with me tonight, dance with me." I love you, baby. You know, that was it. And what was happening is the musicians, the New York Latin musicians, would come around and they would start a jam. Instead of playing straight triads or six chords, we were now going to ninths and augmented 13th chords and 11th chords and substitute chordal systems to expand the harmonies and to be able to play more creative improvisations, more creative music, a kind of mixture of jazz and Latin music together.
So New York took on a kind of life of its own compared to music that was traditionally strictly from Cuba or strictly from Puerto Rico.
Tito had just started his big band, and he would use Doc Severinsen, and he would use Al Kahn and Zoot Sims, and you know, a lot of the jazz guys, Cannibal Adderley, and they would cross over into the Latin scene, and then Tito would reciprocate and play on their albums.
It was a cross-pollinization of one another, and I think the Latins got plenty from the jazzers, and the jazzers got plenty from the Latins.
No jazzer got more than Dizzy Gillespie, who went to his mentor Mario Bauzá looking for the African-Cuban sound for his own band.
The story goes that Dizzy was talking to Mario, saying, you know, Cuban rhythms, man, it's so, you know, it's so deep. There's so many different variations. And the rhythm that we use in jazz is pretty limited. You know, it's just swing, a couple of variations of that, two beat and four beat feels, but that's it. How could we make the rhythm in jazz more interesting? Mario said, man, you just use Latin rhythms. And he said, I know this conga player in Cuba who is a consummate performer, and you've got to meet him. He's a friend of mine. His name's Chano Pozo.
Renowned as a composer, dancer, master percussionist, and showman, Chano was also well-versed in the West African-based religious traditions of Santeria, Palo, and Abakwa. For the first time, jazz was enlivened with African chants and Chano's own explosive drumming.
When a musician like Chano Pozo comes to New York, a proud, dark-skinned Cuban, proud of his African roots and asserting those African roots in the music, it spoke to the American jazz musicians on a level that no one had before. Dizzy Gillespie made a comment, I didn't speak Spanish and Chano Pozo didn't speak English. But that didn't matter because together we spoke African.
Like two long lost brothers separated by slavery, Dizzy and Chano reunited the rhythmic roots of jazz and African-Cuban music in their masterpiece, Mandeca.
Dizzy Gillespie's exploration into Afro-Cuban music was really an exploration into his own African roots.
the bladed musicians were also exploring, hoping to cross over to the respect and riches of mainstream America.
I'd like to present to you my boys playing Gypsy Mambo. This is a combination of flamenco and Afro-Cuban. And we feature, a bunch of foreigners. You know, they don't speak English so good, you know.
The foreigners that Javier Cugat spoke so highly of were the leading Latin musicians of the day.
Cugat was an organizer, an administrator, a talent who understood the situation, did what he needed to do to fit in, and gave us a lot of great music and opportunities for a lot of great musicians.
Also passing through his ranks were vocalists Machito, Miguelito Valdez, and Desi Arnaz, who were all attracted to Cugat's crossover success. No one was more primed than Valdez. Born in Cuba in 1910, Miguelito was childhood friends with Arsenio Rodriguez and Chano Pozo, and as a teenager, sung chorus in a band with Machito. At age 23, he left for Panama and became a heartthrob, then returned to Cuba to thunderous acclaim, recording the hit Babalu in 1939, which became his signature. Disgusted with Cuba's discrimination, Valdez left in 1940 at the height of his popularity and came to the States, first fronting with Cugat, then recording with every major Latin talent, Machito, Cachao, Puente, and Charlie Palmieri, as well as jazzers Dizzy Gillespie, Max Roach, and Quincy Jones.
One of the greatest singers of all time in my book is Miguelito Valdez. Miguelito's voice. And he had black in him, I mean, his background, which he never denied, although he was light-skinned. Yeah. And Desi Arnaz, God bless him, excellent producer, great mind and everything, but as a musician, after Miguelito left Cugat, it wasn't the same band. One of the greatest voices I've ever heard, bar none. Tremendous voice, Miguelito Valdez. And he also was a composer.
Though successful, Valdez was never a sensation. That distinction belonged to Desi Arnaz, who appropriated Valdez's hit song and style and became the king of crossover. While Arnaz soared, the talent at the Palladium struggled.
You were at the mercy of the recording company. When I signed my contract with Mr. Morris Levy, and I was signing my contract with Symphony Sid on my left, Jack Cook on my right, there was a woven tapestry on top of his chair, and it said, "Oh Lord, bring me a bastard with talent." And that's how you sign your contract.
It's not in the days of like today where you've got agents and managers and lawyers and business managers to insulate the artist, you know, from that. In the old days, it was just the artist. They didn't have anybody. And many cases, the agent and the promoter or the agent and the record label owner were in cahoots with one another.
Many people don't realize that are aficionados of this music that Tito Puente, Tito Rodriguez, and Machito were almost known to a certain extent as local artists.
All the noise now because of the Latinos who are like crossing over, you know. In those days, you didn't have to cross anywhere. You just met.
Tito Puente used to have conversations with me telling me about, yeah, when I was at RCA, the biggest record company in the world, they always treated me like I was some local artist. So you can imagine what that does to a person who has this incredible musicianship and this consummate band.
Every time they ask me, well, Tito or Mr. Puente, what do you think about crossover? Huh? I said, crossover? Man, I'm on my way back. What are you kidding?
So it was only natural for Tito to be frustrated and to try to get on the next level. He, oddly enough, he did get on the next level when in 1969, 70, Carlos Santana records Oye Como Va.
Way after Oye Como Va came out, and he said, I played a month one night in Boise. And a man yelled out, "Tito, play some Santana music." So Tito looked out over his drums like this, and he went, "I only play Puente music." He went home one day, and he opened up his mailbox, and in his mailbox was a royalty check for Oye Como Va. And he opened it up, and he went, he threw it in the bank, he called up the same guy from Boise, he says, "From now on, all I play is Santana music."
Above the fray, Machito and his Afro-Cubans took their music beyond America's judgment to Europe and the Far East. Inspired by Desi Arnaz's success, Tito Rodriguez created a song and dance routine and opened the review in Vegas.
It was disappointing that he wanted to do the soft shoe and the thing with the top hat. He put on two guns, and he would sing, "My name is Hopalong Tito," bang, bang. And they threw us out of Vegas immediately. We did a month in Vegas, and then he changed his mind. He never did it again. And then he comes back and then puts an incredible orchestra in the years 1963 when he brings in Cachao. Ray Santos was in it, Mario Rivera, and Victor Paz playing the lead trumpet. There was nothing to talk about. Incredible, incredible orchestra.
Performing at the Palladium was still a rite of passage, one worth fighting for.
When I went against the Palladium to get into the Palladium, they wouldn't let me in. I rented a place called the Riviera Terrace, and in front, right there on Wednesdays, "It's over here, folks, not over there." And you saw up there Machito and Charlie Palmieri, my brother, and "It's not there, it's over here." And little by little, I started to take people away from the Palladium, and the old man used to be very nervous. "Mr. Simon, what's the matter? That kid's crazy. He's crazy." You know, and then Jose Cubello, who was the agent that was the band leader that turned agent, he had Tito Puente, told him, "Well, then you better book him, because he's very hot," you know, with the accent. "He's very hot, and you better book him." Okay, okay. And then they once they booked me and I got in, and then the war started.
Eddie's contribution, besides his enormous body of work, is that he invented the trombone sound. Where most of the small bands always used trumpets, Eddie invented a style that was a rhythm section, a singer, a flute lead, and two trombones, Jose Rodriguez and Barry Rogers. And to this day, lovers of Latin music from the 60s that heard that band view it as one of the most, if not the most, exciting of all the orchestras.
We clobbered every band that we played in there with. Everyone got clobbered by La Perfecta. You couldn't stop that band.
Cuba, 1962. The beginning of the embargo and the end of the source of inspiration for African-Cuban music.
Up until 1960, the Cuban bands were coming to the Palladium, so I used to get to see Orchestra Aragon, and get to see Benny Moray, and get to see Arsenio.
After the revolution in 1959, since the source of the music and the inspiration of the music was cut off, you still had the musicians in New York that grew up listening to Afro-Cuban-based music, were influenced by it and performing it, so they kept the torch of the music alive.
They were really Afro-Cuban musicians, happened to be Puerto Rican or happened to be American living in New York. So they started pushing it more Americanized.
The music of the Palladium had gone global. But at Broadway and 53rd Street, the home of the Mambo, it was the end of the line.
I knew of the raid forthcoming. It was one of the worst kept secrets in Manhattan at that time.
There was a district attorney, an assistant district attorney in Manhattan. His name was Dick Q. And he had a secretary who went to the Palladium.
And she went to the ladies' room. And I don't know what she smelled in there, or somebody sitting on the seat there, or what it was. But she didn't like the odor.
Three different people offered her drugs, mostly marijuana. But there were other things if you wanted it, too.
Heroin was the drug of trade, smoking heroin. The cocaine scene really didn't start till much later, although there was a little bit. Of course, I never indulged, but, you know, but I watched a lot. See, we said we didn't like the drug, we just liked the ritual.
The guy, in effect, spearheading this raid was a very intimate friend of mine by the name of Sonny Grazzo. So it was Sonny Grazzo and Eddie Egan, the very famous detectives from the French Connection case, who closed down my place, in effect. I've never forgiven him for it.
And it was an exciting evening.
Going in, I remember there's a very funny account where Sonny tells me Eddie Egan was dressed in sailor's uniform.
because he used to like to wear disguises. And he says they're standing outside, they're ready to go in, and Eddie Egan was in his sailor uniform, and these two guys from Harlem were coming by, and they were going in, and they said, hey, there's Eddie Egan, and they spotted him right away.
Two busloads of police came, and they parked in front of Birdland. And then somebody, one of them blew a whistle, and they ran up Broadway at two abreast or three abreast. One line went up the front entrance, and one line went up the back entrance.
Eddie would switch the lights off in the Palladium. By the time he put the lights back on, all the cops were all inside the Palladium.
I happened to be there that night because one of our favorite singers was performing there that night, Rolando Lacerio was his name, and I had done a beautiful album with him.
When they threw the lights back on, there was a lot of hardware on the floor, and according to the detective who grabbed Rolando Lacerio, who by that time was the big Cuban singer, he said that he had discarded this glassine envelope.
Everybody threw whatever they had up in the air, as they said, hands up. They went, hands up. I remember I hid in the bathroom, in a stall in the bathroom.
I felt sorry for this guy, Max Hyman, who ran the place, and he got ticketed because he owned the joint. Here he was living way the hell out in Jersey, and the big thing was he had just spent $25,000 putting a new floor in the Palladium because of all the jumping and doing the mambo and everything else in the place. And the talk around that, he said to somebody, crying out, they were going to come. Why didn't they come before I put the floor in? You know what I mean?
It's just the police department trying to make good their record, show that they raided the Palladium.
I feel the raid was unjustified, but that's history. I just was so shocked that from somebody saying somebody offered her drugs, that this whole place that was part of New York City was closed down.
I remember them padlocking the place, and what a shame.
The place was so full of music and good time and enjoyment. Over 30 years later, we're still talking about the Palladium, you know?
The Latin music revolution, begun by Mario Bauzá and Machito, ignited by Tito Puente and Tito Rodriguez, and inspired by the thousands who entered the Palladium doors, lives on. Today, the legacy of the Palladium can be heard, appropriately, at Birdland.